Борис. И я работаю архитектором софт-сервера. И вот весь одна маленькая обратная сторона. Софт-сервер у нас официальный и как это preferred communication English, а communication language is English. Поэтому я буду продолжать по-английски, а вам предлагаю пострадать. Окей, come back. My name is Borys and I'm working as an architect at SoftServe. And as I have just explained, SoftServe is the preferred communication language. English is the preferred communication language in SoftServe. So I have to continue in English. I'm really sorry for that.
Ukrainian also.
Okay, I'll do the titles. Hey, but seriously, if you have like really big problems in understanding me, then you know, raise your hand and I was born and raised Ukrainian, but I spent most of my adult life living in the Netherlands, in Amsterdam. And I was doing many interesting things there in Amsterdam. But I will not tell you about them. Because I will talk about my work. And yeah. One of the things I was doing there, I was doing my doctoral research and I got a degree of doctor from the Free University of Amsterdam. That sits in the world top 100 universities worldwide. And I was working in several international companies, mostly working with heterogeneous data. And I'm sitting in the Java world, so if you're sitting in the .NET world and you're in the other church, I wouldn't understand you. And by the way, that's me.
No way.
I keep surprised myself. And you know what, we tend to be isolated. Our systems tend to be isolated. And can you imagine you made a system and you have a user and your system tells to that user something like that. That our cycling works by stopping the growth of bacteria. And you have a user who looks at that, you know, with the crap you are writing. What does the tetracycline mean? Imagine you found a user who doesn't know what the tetracycline means. What would you do with that user?
Shoot.
Bad idea. A. Make him pay. He should be punished. Yeah. And the other thing is of course, you know, be nice to that poor guy and explain him. Explain him that tetracycline is that. And he'll say, yeah, now I see those old rings and all the stuff. Effectively, what I'll be talking about, what you said, terms, terminologies. Those small links between your system and the rest of the world. So like in this case, you have the word that nobody understands, but you explain what does that mean, and of course everyone now has a clear picture of what the tetracycline means. In other words, I will talk about databases. Well, this is another example, like in quotes, X's, etc. And terminologies, terms like pairs. So we see like it's an X and it's a tools. And it sits in Paris, and you have terminology that explains that Paris is a city with 2.1 million inhabitants, stuff like that. I will talk about having those records linked to those vocabularies, to those terminologies. So if you have the first record that sits in Lyon, then you can say, hey, it is linked to Lyon, and Lyon sits in France, and all this stuff. On the other side, you have another database, and you might have a record that talks about France, and you can say, hey, link it to France. You see that. Okay. And I'll talk I'll limit the whole story about the company, or about the private cloud, so I'll be not talking about the web, and not talking about you know, the global databases and other stuff, but just think about your corporate data. And as an architect, I'm supposed to talk about, you know, abstract things, about architectures, design patterns, and all this stuff. So we'll be talking about a design pattern. And a design pattern, you know, is a reusable solution to a common problem that is designed in a certain specific context. So it's not a universal solution, but something that you can actually apply. And I'll talk about three cases. So I'll show three use cases, three problems, three applications, and I'll describe three application patterns, design patterns that help us to solve those problems. And I'll share a few practicalities, but we'll see. So terminologies, what are they? I'll be talking about them. So. Let's start with what do they mean. In linguistics, we have the notion of vocabulary. So these are vocabulary, these are like all the words known and used by a particular person. It's the standard definition. In computing, I would say that vocabulary is a database of terms known and used by your system. And in the scope of this presentation, basically, terminology is exactly the same as vocabulary. So where terms say, let's say, one of frontiers has 200,000 inhabitants. It is pretty much the same as a taxonomy. Taxonomy is another word for vocabulary that stresses the hierarchical structure of the terms. So it can say that Ivano-Frankivsk is a part of Ivano-Frankivsk region and it's a part of Ukraine. It's kind of hierarchical structures. A terminology is also a thesauri. That's again another word for it that stresses the fact that you have synonyms. For example, you can have a synonym to Ivano-Frankivsk that will say that it's Stanislavov in Polish, for example. And generally, terminology is a database. And the authors of terminologies tend to talk about them as databases. And those tend to be like very specific databases. For example, geographical terminologies. They may be describing, this is the geonames, they may be describing Paris as something, you know, the place in the hierarchy that is Paris, Paris, the city center sits in the Paris, the city as we know it inside the gates, the bigger Paris, the district, the region of Paris, and then it goes up to France. They may describe Ivano-Frankivsk exactly in the same manner, but just a different state on top of it. Other terms are terms like human. So that's the way it is defined in the Cambridge Dictionary. So that's a man, a woman, or a child. Another example of term is the same human, but not in the general purpose dictionary, but in the catalog of life. The catalog of life is a specific database of species. So there are 3 million species that are known to the humanity, and one of those species is a human. And you see, if in the common sense definition, you define human as a man, a woman, or a child, then here we define it as something that has a place in the hierarchy. Yeah? So this has the genus, the family, the superfamily, the order, etc. And the primary name is the Homo sapiens. It has a common name, so one of them is human. So that's a very different perspective on humans. You may get another perspective on a human from the Gamut dictionary. That's effectively an environmental dictionary developed by the European Commission. And here, when they talk about a woman, they talk about an adult, human, female, and pretty much that's it, a few translations. Another example, let's come back to tetracycline. And this is how tetracycline is described in the chemical vocabulary called CAG. And you see exactly the same picture. Why do you think you have the same picture? Why it's the same as the one you saw before?
Similar.
It's exactly the same.
Okay.
It was I copy pasted it. Yeah, but hey, they're talking about tetracycline as a chemical. That's the chemical substance with a formula, with blah blah blah. It participates in certain reactions. It has certain chemical properties. So that's the chemical. That's this white substance. They also have the drug database. Drug in the sense of medicine, not in the sense of Amsterdam. And here they talk, you see here they say that this tetracycline is exactly the same as this DOO201, and this is the DOO201. And here they talk about exactly the same tetracycline, but they're talking about the simicin. Now it comes with another name, but here they're interested in the medical properties of that white substance. So it has the antibacterial properties, for example. And they talk about other reactions. How does it react with the human body? So that's a different perspective on the same tetracycline. That's a different terminology or a different vocabulary. So terminology is a database. basically, it's a very focused, specific database that is typically made by somebody else. And typically, it has just a handful of relations. And it may contain millions of DOMs, millions of records. And why you may need it? It is something that you can take off the shelf, if you are lucky, put it into your system, link it to a data, and bring some added value. Quickly bring some added value, again, if you are lucky, and I will tell you how to get lucky. You have questions, comments so far? So we'll continue with three cases and three design patterns. Let's start with the first one. It comes from Europeana, and Europeana is my former employer. And that's a foundation that sits central in the European cultural heritage. It was founded by the European Commission, and it is funded by special decisions of the European Parliament. And they do many interesting things, like different events, marketing stuff, etc., etc. But as a side activity, they maintain the portal, the portal europeana.eu. And that's an aggregator of for thousands of museums, archives, libraries. And now it shows 43 million objects there. So basically, different museums have their paintings. And what they do, they give the descriptions of those paintings to Europeana. And Europeana puts them all together in one big portal. Each record is described with a dozen of text fields, and they are all stored and made available for search use and so on. Very standard layout. So how does it look like? This is their front page. Imagine you're searching for a woman in Paris. You get very interesting autocomplete indeed if you read it all together. Do you see it from the back? But there is no nothing mystic behind it. This is just a standard autocomplete pulled from the field title. If you start searching, you get something that you should expect, like you get images of women. Let's click on this yellow one, this one. Well, you get a typical cultural object. This is a French postcard. It is about something, post, telegraph, telephone. It's, well, doesn't say much more about it. There is an image, of course. And it comes from the National Library of France. And we found it, yes. We're searching for Jeanne à Paris, and we found this postcard. How did we find it?
Because women like talking.
What?
Because women like talking.
Because women like talking.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah? Other ideas?
They have
no, well, they don't. I wrote for them, they don't. Well, they have that. They have women in Paris. Don't ask me why a French postcard stored in the National Library of France only has the English annotation subject woman. But if you scroll down, you do have them what they call the auto-generated text. Basically, we found the word Paris there, here. We linked it up, what they call tagging, we tagged it, with the vocabulary term from GeoNames. This is the identifier of the vocabulary term. And we pulled all the names of Paris in different languages and merged it into that solar record. So we actually found one of those. We did exactly the same thing with the woman. Again, we saw the subject woman. We looked in this environmental vocabulary. Basically, we looked in another vocabulary. We found the term woman there. It comes from different translations. That's the translation we managed to find. So it is not because women like to talk. Because of that thing. And that's what's going on in the hood. So we have the original record, we have the original French text. We put it in the solar record. We link it up to the Paris from one vocabulary. We pull the translations in, we add it to the same solar record. Then we also go up the hierarchy you know, up to the Paris of Fog, Paris and the France, up to France, and we also pull the translations in. And you know why we do that? It's a French app. It's a French library. They have limited budget. They need to annotate their records. And they need to say, where does that record sit? So they say, Paris. That's obvious, yeah. For a Frenchman, you know, Paris, it's Paris, yeah. In the context of French, to the French National Library, that's an absolutely valid solution, absolutely valid label. Everyone understands what Paris means. If you pull that record into an international aggregator, put it next to Italian, German, etc. records, then it's not that obvious that that's exactly that Paris they mean. Somebody who will be searching for, just, you know, give me a French postcard. They will type France, postcard. They would never find a postcard that only says that it is in Paris. They did not type Paris. They want French postcards. And that's actually the example of isolation that I started with. From the French perspective, it's enough to say it's in Paris. But once you move it to the broader context, to the international context, then suddenly this Paris, not saying that it's not only Paris but also French record, makes it totally isolated. People searching for French stuff not find stuff from Paris. That's why we pull all the translations of France into the solar record. That means if you're searching for French stuff, you'll find it, even if they never mention that. We did exactly the same stuff with women. It gets a little bit trickier here. I mean, what is the broader term for Paris is obvious. Yeah, we go up to France. Try to guess.
Human.
What is the broader term? Human?
Female.
Female?
Homo sapiens.
Homo something? Muse, inspiration, motivation. It's population structure. And you know why? What's wrong with you being a population structure? No. Absolutely. We pulled it from the environmental vocabulary. That was the very specialized vocabulary that had their own specialized view of the world. And the environmental vocabulary talks about pesticides, farms, cows, etc., etc. And for them, human is not like the muse or, you know, the lady or anything like that. For them, human is somebody who digs potato.
A little bit nice, it's just population structure.
This is again another example, like, look, vocabularies are isolated. And they're meant with their own design goals. Environmental vocabulary may be relevant, but it has their own view of the world that may be different from the general cultural view of the world. But hey, it's very useful. So this is the first pattern. What we had the database with the original records, and we had two terminologies, the geographical one and the environmental one. So we linked them up, what we call tagging. We added those two lines. Then we merge them together into this solar record, where we merge them, you know, the relevant terms. Then what we have the user who is not aware of that stuff, who is not aware of those vocabularies and the links between them. But he's just searching solar and he can find the French record, and if he's searching for a population structure, then he can find a woman. But hey, this is the first application and the first way to get lucky with vocabularies. Or terminologies. Questions? Comments? All happy? Wow. The second one. That's multimedia again. That's my former employer. That was a Dutch R&D project. It was completed in 2006. And what we did there, we had several museums, several cultural institutions with their own databases and with their own vocabularies. Actually those. And we link them up. And well, we see that some of them is a part of the Louvre collection. It's probably the most well-known. The other one, for example, this Arcadei people. It is the Dutch registry of all people who have something to do with culture. So if you have a small local, exposition of your own photographs, and if it hits the press, then they will find it, they will write it down that you, Vasa Pupkin, has the exposition, blah, blah, blah. So actually, like in the Netherlands, in a small country, they found 300,000 people who have something to do with culture. Okay, anyway. We link them all up together, but what we just created a big, giant mess. It's, if you have it, it's a nice slide, but how to navigate and how to make use of it. And what we did something like that. So we have a black box, we put them all together. We had the search box, and of course we were all inspired by Google, we just had that small search box. And we had the autocomplete. So if you start typing something, for example, we start typing dollar, what they were doing, you type dollar, it was searching all of those vocabularies and all of those databases, finding things that match your query and grouping them up. For example, you see these are the artifacts. So these are the database records. And you see, like, you type dollar, you have some dollar signs. What else can you find? The other group would be the concepts, the abstract terms. Not the specific coins, but the abstract notions. Yeah? So dollar is the monetary unit. Dollar coins, like the abstract idea of dollar coin. Dollar diplomacy, and by the way, dollar diplomacy is not what is happening now. Dollar diplomacy was a very specific policy that the United States were making against Latin America in the beginning of the previous century. It is not just culture. The other group was the geographical terms. We again grouped geographical terms together and showed them like that. And again, dollar is an inhabited place. How can you guess? The dollar is a mountain. What if it is in front? So that thing, what does it allow us? It allows us, looking at this whole mess, to go straight to the specific terms, to the specific databases that may be relevant to our query. Here we do choose where do we want to go, and then we go straight to that part of the data of this cloud. What are we doing under the hood? We have again the databases, we have the terminologies, we link them up. And then you as a user start typing something, we search all of them, then we group the results together, and you see those groups. This is the second way to get lucky with databases and terminologies. Questions, comments?
Group by text.
What?
Well, groups. Group by text. How we group them?
By the type of term.
Type of term. Sure.
Term. So we group general terms, locations, database records, people, and I think there were a couple of more, but they don't show up in this example. Yeah.
Talking back about merge. Pattern. So when we're talking about Paris and France, we're humans and we can understand that it's about city and the country, but tech wilding, is it something that's done automatically by a computer? How does computer know that he need to widen Paris into France?
Yes, thank you. It's a good question, because in the vocabulary, in geonames, they explicitly say that Paris is a part of France. It doesn't say that Paris is a part of Italy, for example. And so we program it to go up the hierarchy.
So we have like a list of vocabularies, and we go through them and widen text by each of vocabularies, right?
Yes, but this is Yes, absolutely. But this is the simple case. We go only up. Mm. And I will, the next case would be about going left and right. More questions?
How in case when, for example, city has the same name as, for example, Sofia, how do you know that the city and not a human?
Yeah, it's again a great question. I have a few slides on that.
Okay.
More questions?
Come back to that wonderful slide with you know, many databases.
Each circle there is a database. But what sits inside the database?
So that's one of those, it's a very central one, is the Getty AAP concepts.
Again, we're talking about the cultural domain here. And what they describe, this is pretty much the structure of the data that we worked with. So you can see, like, say, portrait of Matisse, that's an artifact, so that's the instance of class artifact. That can have an author, that is a person, it may be Durer, who may be worked in certain style, who may have worked at certain place, for example, Paris, and an artifact may have been made at a certain place, relations like that. And we just talked about this autocomplete and grouping the information before we search. What happens if we ignore the grouping, ignore that assistance, and just, you know, search? You know, if you have those 20 databases linked together, let's just search. And something interesting comes up. We could, of course, make the standard solar system. You search for the rare, you have like 100,000 records returned, each of them would have Durer mentioned somewhere. That would be cool, but we would never get funding for the R&D project that Eurogano was. We were not just returning things where you find textual match of the query. We are looking at the query, we are matching it with all the different terms in that graph, and we are searching for meaningful clusters of terms, of records, of basically anything from that graph, meaningful subgraphs, that can somehow be related to a search query, and where we can explain the relation. Look at the first one. This is the easy one. We are searching for Durer, and we found cluster that is described as work created by someone. So we found Durer, and it has a relation, works created by Durer, and we pull those works. And this is the first cluster. It's easy to see it has Durer everywhere as the author. That's kind of, at least Durer is mentioned. The other one is works titled with Durer. Actually, those are not works of Durer. Those are works made by somebody else, for example, by Matisse. But still, at least Durer is mentioned. Yeah, it's mentioned in the title. Here it gets interesting. These are the works that are made in the same style period that where Durer was also working at. They are not works by Durer, they're just works by somebody else who worked in the same style. And they don't have Durer mentioned anywhere. Actually, they're all from Matisse here, but doesn't have to be Matisse. And this is something that's ultimately relevant to Durer. This is the same style. He inspired them, or they were kind of inspired each other, whatever. But anyway, that's the result that you would never receive from the plain text-based search system. Neither from Solr nor from Elasticsearch. That's this graph-based advanced search that we're doing. You can go further. This one is talking about the pool of London. You can go further in the tree, yes? You see this is London, you can link it to the geonames term. And you can, you know, make another step in this graph and, for example, search for things that are related to London. You can have works where subject is the narrower of London. This one is made in Greenwich, or subject is Greenwich. Greenwich is a part of Greater London, so that's why you have it. Again, London may not be mentioned here at all. Another example is we can get artifacts like photographs, where the subject is a person who was active in London. And I think one of them was a Dutch ambassador to London, to England. But anyway, you get records that are related to London. Of course, they're also somehow related to Durer, but in a relation that is a little bit fuzzy. Yeah, they have something to do with London, and he depicted London on one of his paintings. But okay, what we're doing under the hood? We have the databases, we have the terminologies from that slide. We link them up together. And we were walking through from the database to terminology, and then to other database, into another terminology, until we find something meaningful, basically. That's the third design pattern, what you can do with your databases and terminologies, again, if you want. And you know, if you do that in the cultural sector, what can you find? I can tell you. Nothing. And you know why? Because they're all dead. That's art. You know, to be important, you need to die first. It sounds a little bit different if you are a pharmaceutical company. Imagine you're not talking about those styles of paintings, and not paintings, but you're talking about living humans, their diseases, chemicals that can, you know, help those humans with the diseases. What can you find then? Yes, money. Yes, you can find drugs, and you can find money. Who cares about drugs? Yeah. And now is the turn for a few practicalities, how to, you know, implement that happiness. One is how to get the terminologies. I mean, it's all nice, I'm always talking. You have a database, and you link it up to the terminology, and, you know, here the money comes from. Well, if you are lucky. Basically, again, terminology is something that is very specific and very scarce. You may be lucky. You may be typically you're lucky with places. You have geonames that is free, it has many minerals places. You'll be more lucky if you're interested in places in the States, because they're described with much more detail than, for example, Ukrainian places. Another good place is gamut. This is the environmental vocabulary. And the good thing there, it comes in 27 languages. So you have like 20, 30,000 terms, and you have free translations. Well, if you want to check if you're lucky or not, buy a lottery ticket. If you win something, keep Googling. If you don't, then you are the regular, you need to pay. Examples of the paid vocabularies, okay, remember the first slides, those chemical stuff. This is a typical example of a paid vocabulary. If you are doing something in that sector, then look at CAG, maybe you'll find their license acceptable. But the sad thing that even if you're able to pay, you may not find the vocabulary that you need. And you may well end up making one yourself. But basically, that's another story. The second practicality. We have two more to go, the second and the third. I kept talking about, you know, you get the databases, you get the terminologies, and you link them up. It's easy to say, hey, just link them up and you're done, yeah? But exactly the problem that you asked about, you know, we come back to the postcard. We have woman in Paris, and we have Paris. And we start searching German names for Paris. Easy to do, yes? Okay, you pull that word, you start searching. Have you been in this, I would say, dramatic situation where your girlfriend asks you, darling, could you please bring me to Paris?
Yes.
If you love me, of course. Have you ever been there?
No.
Yes. No. Guys, that's a small question for you.
guarantee. No, I don't.
You know what should you answer? Yes, yes, which one? Never say yes or no, just refine the question. I try to guess how many Paris's are out there?
A lot.
Guess.
Yes.
Give me the number.
A cafe, some building name is like Paris, some place name is like a Paris. Whatever.
Some woman.
And the last one is Paris, real Paris.
That one.
Yes.
Yeah. Exactly. She didn't mean that one.
Yeah.
You can be sure. Hey, but any idea? Number?
1,000.
Yeah, absolutely. It's 3,700 Paris is mentioned in the specialized geonames vocabulary. So you have a choice. Yeah, you all laughing. It's easy, which one you want to go in, of course. No, but for us writing computer programs, it's much more difficult. Because what's wrong with number 3? Okay, what's wrong with number 1? It is expensive.
Number 1 is the city and the region.
Absolutely. The first one is the city center inside the gates. It is extremely expensive. The third one includes some of the suburbs. You see, there are more people living there. And not much more, so it is still extremely expensive. But what's wrong with number 5?
It's excellent.
It's mountain.
It's romantic, it's a mountain.
Antarctica,
nobody lives there. I think it's the biggest problem. Yeah. You want to, if you go to Paris, you want a restaurant, yes? There is nobody there. So, what to do here? There are like two ideas. First one is search for the restaurants. I mean, seriously, if there is a place and there is no place to eat, why would you go there? The other one is look for population. And again, like mountain Antarctica, there is nobody living there, and probably you don't want to have it in your system. The other problem here is that, and it's extremely typical problem, for every city, you typically have Paris the city center, the historical city. Paris the city as we know it, Paris the greater, Paris with suburbs, Paris the region, the capital region. Typically also have Paris the province or something like that. So whatever, even if you find the right Paris, you always have them kind of nested into each other. The same with Berlin and the same with everyone else. And as a tip, here a tip is easy, choose the most specific one. If you see they're nested, you just get the most specific one, it's easy to put on the map. This way, if somebody wants you to bring her to London, you would actually bring her to Westminster, Westminster somewhere in London. But it's okay, maybe okay with Paris, but if you want to go to Athens. And you can find two Athens, Athens in Greece and Athens in Georgia. And by Georgia, I mean Georgia the state in US and not Georgia the state. And both of them are fairly populated places. You do have people and restaurants everywhere. How to choose? Well, programmed. Basically, drop what you don't need. Filter the data because there are many, many things in geonames, like 20 million or something like that. Typically, you would need like maybe 10,000 in your system. You can, in many cases, you can only restrict it to administrative units, like cities, regions, etc., and skip all the parks, rivers, banks, etc. But watch out. If you're making a site for a hiking website, then you can actually skip all those administrative units, but you do want to keep the rivers and the hills. So you may be filtering on the other side. Well, you can of course use time constraints. If there is an antique statue from Athens, then they're probably talking about the other Athens. But basically you need to program it. What to do with the where? There's also a nice example. It's again a very, very common case in cultural heritage. When they're talking about civilizations, they tend to mix together place and time. So when they're talking about, say, ancient Greece, they're talking about that specific part of the world and that specific time. When they're talking about, say, the Holy Roman Empire, again, specific place and specific time. and things like that. And that creates a very nice challenge for us, the programmers, because they mix up what and where. We have the vocabulary of places, we can have the vocabulary of time or anything else, and we kind of cannot decide which one to use, because they mention both. I had a nice case, once I was doing this work for Europeana, and I was happily taking data, and all went smooth, and then I put it on the map. And suddenly I found a small village in the middle of France with 20 inhabitants and with like a million artifacts there. Should be like that in the most, you know, cultural place on earth. And yes, it was called Roman. So there were millions of pots. They were labeled as Roman. And they were all fitted in that village. How to avoid that? Well, put records on the map. Basically test it. Visualize it, put it on the map, you will see it. The other type of problem is disambiguating people. Again, like which Paris to go? I mean, you have Paris the city and Paris the lady. It is in cultural sector, it is also very difficult because there are millions of people involved there. Again, even in the Netherlands, they have 300,000 people who are registered. And just the Netherlands, a tiny country. It's easy in cultural heritage sector because, again, anyone who is important tends to feel the death field in. Before you get important, you cannot get important if you do not feel it in. So that restricts the number of people you need to search. At the time, it's maybe the easiest. I mean, it's like linear, one-dimensional thing. It tends to be very numeral, so there are lots of numerical values like years, early 13th century. It's kind of the easiest one. Again, just stay in the past. Again, once looking for Europeana, I found that a museum was dating their records in the future. There's a historical museum that was providing records about the future. It's nice. They were also talking about the future wars. That's interesting. Hey, the tip is put it on the timer. I mean, this is a very cheap idea. Search and a few rules to disambiguate, to find the right pairs. It's the cheapest way of tagging data. How far we can go with it? And this is the data again from Europeana. And one of the reasons I'm talking about Europeana is that there is no NDA in that company. That's public cultural heritage. There is no non-disclosure agreement. So I can talk about it. I cannot talk about, say, the pharma biotech area. And what we had like in 2009, we had like nearly 20 million records there. And we applied this idea that it was just described. And what we get like several million links to the very practical cultural records. And this was like 5 million links. But you know what does that mean? Each link comes with 20 plus multilingual synonyms. What does that mean? That you spend like 1, 2, 3, 5 days of work and you brought 100 million links between records, practically for free. And that's quite a result. Questions, comments? The final bit. Remember this slide, yes? We are receiving clustered results, we are receiving those paintings that were made in the same style period as Durer was working in. Basically what we had this graph, or something like that. And what we were doing, we found Durer somewhere in it, and hey, we found the link, their style, and we found a nice little subgraph, and we see, hey, we can explain it, you know, Durer's style, people worked with him. So there's a nice small subgraph. Here's the result. Maybe other nice subgraphs. Maybe this one. Maybe it's also a nice one. Yeah. So sometimes you find those little nice graphs that you can show us the results. There are also like two extreme problems there. One is that Durer may have worked in the place called Nowhere or whatever else. And we're searching here and we go to the dead end. So there is a node in the graph, and nobody else was, you know, is linked to that node. And that happens very, very often. But that's also the small problem. The bigger one is, especially in modern art, the bigger one is Paris. Everyone in modern art has something to do with Paris. Literally everyone should have worked there, been there, wrote about Paris, anything. So once you hit Paris, you suddenly have so many roads, you know, leading to Paris that you don't know which one to choose. And this is a big problem because kind of from one side everyone is linked to it. This is the source, this is the proxy of many interesting results. But again, there are too many things going in and it's very, very difficult to choose. Questions? Well, basically you can do two types of search. One of them is explorative search. It's like, here is the graph, here is a query, go through that query, find something interesting. Find those, you know, people who worked in the same style. And that's technically it's a very difficult one. Because what you do, we try to find meaningful graphs, but we look at the graph topology, we look at the structure. It's a little bit like we have many texts, and we look at the text structure and try to find which text is meaningful. So look at the text map, two paragraphs, nine sentences, not meaningful. The other one, oh, six paragraphs, 11 sentences, and one exclamation mark. Hey, that's a nice text. It's a little bit like that. So it's tricky. Well, it's a big problem. No real recipe. The other type of search is the targeted search. For example, multimedia, what we were doing, we had two guys, Van Hoog and Gauguin, and they were all from the same area, and they were intimately connected. There was a very strong connection between them. And we tried to find the connection between them, looking through their graph. And we basically failed, because the type of connection between them was not reflected in the graph structure. But it's still another type of search. Imagine you're a chemical plant, and you can produce alcohol. You know, you have the keg, you have the chemical vocabularies, you know, you are making alcohol. And you can have, like, you know, the list of diseases, for example, flu. And an example of this directed search may be, hey, here is a graph, here are you guys, find me any explanation how can I possibly treat flu with alcohol. Find that link somehow. What's good with that when I was doing that in 2005, 6, 9, we were practically void of tools, there were no tools that could help me. Now you're in a much better situation because you do have Neo4j as the system to store your graph scene. You do have different systems like Apache Giraffe or GraphX based on Spark to analyze them massively. You can have clusters to parallelize your search. And you have your money, maybe. To summarize, we looked at the three cases, three scenarios, three patterns. You know, one to merge it all together, and actually make the user unaware that you have all those vocabularies under the hood. The other one is to be explicit, to search those vocabularies and group them nicely, and make the user aware that there are vocabularies, and make him choose vocabulary terms. And finally, the third one is to look at that graph and find something that may be meaningful and that maybe a user would like. So that's the clustering task. So these are the three patterns, the three scenarios. And if you talk about the future, the best way to talk about the future is to look in your past. And you know this, maybe know this, human books. Basically, the database systems were designed in the 70s. This is the very late book. I just was able to find the cover of the book. But I was using the book from the 70s when I was studying. And the databases, they had the adequate hardware in the last 20 years. And they managed to grow in what we know as database systems that are sitting everywhere. Exactly the same thing should happen with the graph theory. Simply because now we do have the hardware, we also have a lot of motivation, like the social networks. Literally everyone is linked to those global graphs. And we do have the business needs. The businessmen are also looking at those graphs. They see the value in those graphs. And they start thinking of their own business as a kind of graph-based business, interconnected business. And that's why I do believe that the next decade should be more or less the decade of graph theory. I mean, big play. Thank you so much for listening.
Any questions?
There is one in front of.
The biggest question is for me is how to troubleshoot all the systems for irrelevant results. So when you were talking about Romans and 1 million ports, I mean you were likely to find it, right?
Yes.
But we can't rely on fortune when we're talking about production systems. So how can we test it?
Yeah. First of all, divide and conquer. So one thing is steadiness. You can test it. So it's a special type of testing, because quite often when we're testing the code. We're testing the database schema, the piece of code you write. And here, you need to have that in place, yes, but you also need to test at the data level. So if you have a database, you have maybe 20 fields, and you need to test that those 20 fields are nicely connected. That's already a task on its own. But here, in addition to that, you need to look through, say, 20 million records and see that they are also connected in a meaningful way. Yeah? So yes, it's a big challenge. It's a very big challenge. First of all, this is the R&D community. There is a lot of research going on from one side in machine learning, from the other side in conceptual modeling, and in many other areas of computer science. So this is, first of all, this is the research agenda. Say this project with multimedia with many databases is a typical example of a Dutch research project funded by the academia. So this area is still moving from being a research area into being the practical one. And again, the whole story is the matter of luck. Seriously, if you should be really lucky to have the vocabularies that describe your data and describe in such a way that provides meaningful results to the end users. The other answer is who is interested in those type of systems are first of all the high value businesses and high value organizations. Think of pharmaceuticals. This would be the type of organizations that can definitely afford the costs of LinkedIn data, checking them, because you know the stakes are high and they really need that.
If I want to work on the task when I need to classify the data, describe the data, who I am have be? What should be my CV to get into your team?
An architect.
It's data, one of the terms is data science and data architects. And data architects is also a term from, say, business analysis. You know, there's a Pentaho, Mondrian-like things where you get your data, classical data in databases, and you re-engineer it in a way suitable for analysis. There's the data engineer type of work. Large databases, again, you have a data engineer who defines the data structures in a way that you can put it on the relational databases. So this is data engineer, data scientist, and anywhere else, basically.
Just a few questions. Can you share the information about the total size of the databases? The second one, are you using reindexing in SOAR? If so, how long does it take time?
Talking Europeana, like when it had 20 million records, it was, each record had also like several related terms linked to it. But anyway, it was 60 gigabytes on disk. Indexing it with what the table you saw, increase the size of the index by 20% because the new words, they were highly repetitive and it didn't need to store them. But it doubled the number of words sitting in the index. So if you have like 20 million records, that type of records, it was around 60 gigabytes of disk. And indexing, yeah, plus 20%. No real issue there, which is surprising enough. Does it answer the
question? Yes. Question
So you ask about whether we can use machine learning and things like neural network to train this data, yes? It's again a very good question. The answer is yes and no. With neural networks, it's rather no because of the nature of neural networks. But generally with machine learning, it is something to try. The problem there is that typically you have small records and you don't have enough records pre-classified with a certain specific label. So if you have like many records and say five different labels, then it's doable. But if you have like say 20 million records and if you have say 100,000 places, then training becomes a problem. Because basically to train a machine learning algorithm, you need to have several positive and negative examples. Like several records that are known to be in Paris and several records that are not, definitely not sitting in Paris. The last problem with data is that you need to explain why did you tag it. Once people get those results, they often get confused. Especially if they are searching for Durain, they get something where there is no Durain. That's also why being able to explain the results was such of paramount importance. Because simply people also with Europeana were just not understanding what's the rubbish you are returning to us. And that would be the big problem with machine learning if it cannot explain why you're tagging with that specific term. And the easiest way to explain is say, hey, look, it says Paris. So we pull the Paris. If it will say Paris and we'll pull Lyon, because of whatever, then it would be impossible to explain. And that would also eat into trust to the whole process. It's a new process, people don't trust it. Does it answer? Thank you. More comments?
I made it all myself.
seriously?
Yeah, it's true. I want to ask about data prioritization between those groups. How do you specify which will be on top?
The first heuristic would be to count the number of instances. And that's what we're using here. Basically, if you search for, say, dollar, there will be many, many concepts about dollar. Maybe 50, maybe 100. We were only selecting those that have database records linked to it. And the reason is very simple. I mean, you're searching for something, you got a suggestion here, you think that if you click on it, you will get something. So if you have, like, you know, 100 terms about dollar, but only 3 of them have data, then, you know, we'll frustrate everyone who clicks on the pre-selected term that doesn't lead to any data. So that would be the first rule. Check if you have data describing it. And sort of what the number of data that links, the number of records that link to it. Does it answer?
And data here is grouped by that glossaries, or it's like how data is grouped. So it's like question.
Yeah. So you have many records, and they are linked to different terms. Yes. And if you find one term, then you count the number of records that link to it. And you say, hey, there are like, say, three dollar terms. One has 10 records linked to it, the other one has 5. So you put the one with 10 on top.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you.